Thank you, Don. I want to affirm something Jeff McGee said, which is the importance of water. In the 10 or 12 years, I'm not sure how many years this prize exists, I think it's actually 12, at least four of the winners have been recognized for dealing with water issues. And some of the people who got a special recognition award, which is the second award, were also recognized for doing stories involving water. And I think what that shows is that water is the enduring environmental problem of the West. It goes on and on, it'll never end. It's one of the things that we have to deal with here living in the West. Also, journalism covering that topic is going to be important in the days ahead. It's come to your attention, perhaps we have a new administration in Washington, and the new administration is naming people like the head of the EPA and the head of the Department of Interior. None of us know yet what that's going to mean for natural resources and environmental protection. So journalism coverage is going to become increasingly important, I think, in these days. So I'm up here to present the winner of this award. Before recognizing the winner, I want to mention another entry that the judges wanted to honor with a special recognition, which was an excellent five-part series by Abram Lustgarten for the news site ProPublica. The series was called Killing the Colorado, again dealing with a water issue, and in this case the dwindling and much fought over water in the Colorado River and all the questionable decisions over the years about how that water is used and allocated. So congratulations to Abram Lustgarten and ProPublica for that special recognition. So this year's winner of the Knight-Risser Prize is for a very ambitious piece of work that looked at disappearing groundwater supplies, not only in the U.S., but also in a number of countries. The people working on this story went around not only in the U.S., but to India, to Peru, to Morocco, looked at the issues there. And the issue of water depletion, overuse of water supplies clearly exists in very many countries. So their series titled Pump Dry, the Global Crisis of Vanishing Groundwater is the winner of this prize. The authors of this piece of work, which was appeared in print, has also resulted in a documentary film. The authors are Ian James of the Desert Sun newspaper of Palm Springs, and working with him are Steve Elfers, a video journalist with USA Today, and Steve Riley, who's a reporter and data specialist. I'm especially pleased to hand this award today to Ian James because he was a student of mine here at Stanford, the first student of mine, I think, that has won this award, or maybe any award, I'm not sure. But he was a great student. He was in a class of mine that involved public affairs reporting and coverage of environment and related issues. And he has gone on since then to have an outstanding journalism career, and I think it's a testimony to the people who run the Desert Sun, and I'm sure to him for his persistence, that a paper of a very modest size took on such an ambitious project and did it so well. So let me have Ian come up here. I have a plaque for him. The plaques are being sent to his two colleagues who worked on the story also, and they're sharing a check, which in the modern era appears mysteriously electronically in their bank accounts. Ian, this is the plaque. You take over. I'm going to go sit down. You say something.
And was a real inspiration. I think Jim's commitment to improving journalism stood out. And we did a lot of talking about environmental journalism, public service, and investigative reporting that has stayed with me. And it's also an honor to be here representing this team that I worked with, it was kind of an unusual project in that we came together working both colleagues at the Desert Sun and at USA Today across the country talking regularly about this project and what we wanted to focus on. And it grew out of my reporting in California in 2013 and 2014 in looking at the drought and realizing that in the Central Valley and other areas that the problem of declining groundwater levels began long before the drought, will likely continue long after the drought until we get a better handle on it, and is, through the wet and dry periods, it's continued. And so that's what especially interested me about it. And of course, we've seen more of the severe impacts during the drought. People running out of water in the Central Valley. But in addition to that, I was interested in looking at various places where this was an issue, looking at what were the causes, the drivers, and the effects for the people who were most affected by this. And so, reading various accounts of groundwater depletion in different parts of the world, reading scientific papers, and learning about NASA data showing changes in groundwater levels measured by satellites, got me interested in the idea of trying to look at different parts of the world and analyze what's causing this problem and who is it affecting the most and what might be done about it. And that was how this project began. I proposed the idea to my editor, Greg Burton, who said, yeah, run with it. And as Jim said, I think that's a great testament to having, to working in a place where ambitious journalism is welcomed and championed. And from that point, I went to the Pulitzer Center on Crisis Reporting to apply for a travel grant that would enable us to go to some of these other places. First of all, Jeff, I wanted to ask for one slide. When you have a moment, the California one, because we were talking about, I wanted to introduce sort of the long-term trend. And this is actually from a Stanford University report. We included a similar chart in our series. It's really striking how the trend continues through the wet and the dry periods. And I think this chart says probably more than anything else how even though we're entering a wet period now, and it is, there's a ton of snow in the mountains, it's been quite wet. California's water problems continue to be complicated, particularly in the Central Valley and the Southern Central Valley, where the amount of water that's available to naturally recharge the groundwater supplies just pales in comparison to what's pumped out of the ground. And so I think this chart, it explains, gives one view of how big the problem is in California and why it's something we really need to do about, because in California and many other places, we're simply overusing the water that's there, and sooner or later, that will lead to consequences, whether they're planned or not. Whether wells go dry and more people are struggling, or whether it's planned in some way to cut back, to use less, to become more efficient. And so I wanted to move on and talk a little bit about the international portion of the project and how we expanded from California in the West to look at other areas. But one of the resources that we had was to look at NASA groundwater data, measurements from the two GRACE satellites. And I should say that Jay Famiglietti, professor at UC Irvine and NASA JPL, was generous in providing a lot of background information and sort of talking me through his research. He's not the only one, but he was certainly very helpful in this. This is based on their research. This shows that most of the world's major aquifer systems are declining. The color scheme may not be immediately obvious, and there's some that are counterintuitive, such as the Ogallala Aquifer, where there's a lot of depletion, but if you look at the Ogallala as a whole, that's that blue one right there stretching down the middle of our country. It's because in the northern part, it's not quite so bad off, but there are certainly some areas where it's probably, if agriculture continues the way it is, it's just a matter of time until it's really not usable for agriculture in the way it is now. We also looked at satellite measurements that show areas of the world where, since about 2002, the supplies overall of water, both snow and groundwater and lakes, have all diminished. And so that offers something of a guide to where it's really a problem. And it's also an amazing step forward in terms of looking at a large scale at how are the world's water supplies changing. And we combine that with on-the-ground groundwater data sets showing changes in well levels. And then we went out to some of the communities where scientists and water experts told us this is really a problem. There are people who are dealing with some of the most severe effects. And so in India, we went to an area where there have been a number of farmer suicides, some of those apparently related to the lack of water and the financial problems that creates. And we met a family that had drilled wells down hundreds of feet, and they hadn't been able to find water, and they went into debt in the process. And their some of the young people in the family had moved on to the cities. We saw parallels there between what was happening in India with uncontrolled pumping by sugarcane farms and what we see in parts of the Central Valley or Kansas and the Ogallala Aquifer area. And then we also went to Peru, where we read about asparagus farming being a major drain on the water supply. And it's a very dry region, one of the driest regions in all of the Americas. And so these aquifers have been severely drained, and it's affecting communities. And we actually ended up in the middle of what was a violent confrontation between some of the people who didn't want a company to start pumping water there and people who worked for that company. Sort of a long story, but in any case, that's in the series. And so in all these places that we went, we saw small farmers and residents in areas of heavy agricultural water use who were struggling, either with wells that were starting to fail or they had completely run out and were having to either abandon their farmland, as we saw in Morocco, or they were looking for some other solution. And in the course of this project, we also talked to a lot of government officials who are trying to work on this problem, both at the local, state, and the national level, as well as scientists, and came away with a number of principles for groundwater management that can help. And so we listed those, both in the documentary film at the end. I wish I could show the whole film, but that would take a full hour. So in any case, the documentary film at the end, we run through a number of principles which are probably common, or probably a number of you have seen some of these types of principles in terms of the discussion in California about the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act and the work that Water in the West is doing in looking at groundwater issues. But they include monitoring and measuring what's pumped out of the ground at a basic level in a number of major farming regions, both in California and elsewhere. The amount of water that's pumped is not fully tracked. And so that makes it harder to get a handle on, first of all, how much of a problem might there be if we don't start to do something differently? And some of the other principles would include community involvement and discussion about what is the plan going to be, what is it going to look like, and starting to move toward a basin level integrated water management approach. That's, again, what California is trying to move toward. I think everyone agrees that it's going to be a long process. And it's going to be interesting, I think, and important as a journalist to cover how these discussions play out, as to how people will share the water that's there. Because at some point, there's only so much to go around. And we, the farms, the cities, and all the water users need to figure out what's available, particularly in these times when climate change is diminishing, in many cases, the amount of water that is recharging these aquifers. So with that, I wanted to play the first few minutes of our film, which introduces the problem. Oh, and also the potential solutions. Yes, here's the list. This is by no means a complete list. I'm not sure everyone can read it, but these are some of the key concepts that we came away with after dozens of interviews with various people who have looked at this issue. I did want to mention also, water rights. The issue of water rights is very complicated, and of course, our system of water rights has been around for a century, more than a century in the West. And in California, the amount of surface water that's been doled out to various water rights, if you include the junior right holders as well as the senior, and maybe Leon could correct me if there's some imprecision here, but the research that I've seen says that about five times the total surface water that's available in an average year is doled out. So there are a number of water rights that just, we're using a lot of the surface water. There's not a lot to go around. So discussions about water rights in the future could be productive, though also very politically difficult. Another lesson that I came away with is that regulating and limiting pumping in some way is probably going to be important in a lot of areas that are in critical overdraft. And so the difficult discussions may come at the community level in terms of deciding who is going to cut back, who is going to shut down their farm, and how can that be economically viable. I've also written in the past about the town of Borrego Springs in Southern California, that there really are few options other than eliminating most or all of the agriculture that's happening there, because it just won't be able to last. So, and having those discussions is, of course, important and difficult. But I think that's all. There's a long list, and there's more that we can talk about together as part of the panel. So I'd like to introduce the film now. This is the first part of the hour-long film.
Niagara Falls. The impressive flow of water that draws visitors from all over the world is roughly equivalent to the amount of water that is being pumped out of the ground by wells in the United States alone. Much of the planet relies on groundwater, and in places around the world, in regions of Asia, Africa, the Middle East, Latin America, and the United States, so much water is being pumped from the ground that aquifers are being rapidly depleted and wells are going dry.
Is this incredible global phenomenon that we really didn't, we never really understood it the way we understand it now. It's pervasive, and it's happening at a rapid clip.
It will be an understatement to call it serious.
We're getting down to the bottom of that huge pool of water that in the 50s and 60s we thought was inexhaustible.
Groundwater is going down, no exception.
We've passed a point that we've never seen before in history here.
No se hace, no va a hacer desaparecer. Simplemente con el agua. Sin agua, ¿qué vamos a hacer?
With the help of satellite technology, our view is not limited to the surface of the Earth. Locked in a tandem polar orbit, twin satellites named Grace look down at the Earth. Grace's ability to measure small changes in gravitational pull allows it to observe changes in water content from glaciers to groundwater. These satellite measurements show areas around the world where water supplies are declining and where groundwater is being depleted.